Hey everyone, I get a lot of questions about solar nowadays, and I thought I'd share the five most important tips that you need to consider before installing solar. The first thing you need to consider, is your house a good fit for solar? The roof age is probably the most important criteria to consider. If you've got roof shingles that are 20 or 30 years old, I do not recommend installing solar on that roof. You want to replace the roof before you install solar. If you've got an old roof, you got to make sure that it has the proper structure, that it can support the weight and the uplift of the panels. The next thing you got to consider is minimal shade. If you've got a roof that's got a lot of shade from really tall trees that surround the house, it's probably not the best fit for solar. Obstructions. If you've got a lot of plumbing vents, you've got a lot of dryer vents and other obstructions that are coming through the roof, if you've got a lot of dormers, that can make the installation a lot more complicated as far as locating the panels, securing them to the roof. And each one of these obstructions casts a shadow typically, so that can also affect the power output of each panel. Ideally, you'd love to have a south-facing roof with perfect solar exposure. That's ideal. Question we often get is, does it work on an east and west facing roof? And the answer is yes, it does. It's about a 20%, give or take, hit in power output, but definitely is not a deal breaker if you have an east-west roof. The second item to consider is panel types. On the market today, there are traditionally three different types. You have monocrystalline panels, you have polycrystalline panels, and you have thin film solar. Monocrystalline are premium panels. They have a higher price point, but they have a higher efficiency, about 17 to 22% efficient. They typically make up about 50% of the market share. Next is the polycrystalline. Those are the panels that have like a bluish tint to them. They have a lower efficiency at about 13 to 17%, and they're at a lower price point. And then thin film is really the lowest efficiency at 10 to 13% efficient. They typically are integrated with building systems and building materials. So I really see thin film as the future. But for now, I tell most people to focus on a monocrystalline panel, premium panel. Those are the ones that have the highest efficiency. And really due to economies of scale and technological advances, their price point has come down dramatically. The third item to consider is inverter types. Once you've selected your solar panels, those create the electricity as direct current power. But for it to be used in our house, we need it to be AC or alternating current power. And that's where the inverter comes in. There are three different types. The first is a central inverter or a string inverter. Think of each panel on your roof connected in series, like a daisy chain wire from each one and then down to the central inverter. That's typically located in your basement or maybe outside of your house. That system is tried and true. It's used most commonly. It's also the lowest upfront cost. The downside is that if one of your panels fail, you don't know about it. And if one of your panels gets shaded, it knocks the output of the entire array down to that one panel. So it's not the best approach, but it is one that's worth considering. The second iteration on that model is a power optimizer system. The difference here is that you have an optimizer, a little device that's mounted underneath each panel. And what that allows each panel to do is operate optimally. So if one gets shaded, it's not going to affect the entire array. The rest of the wiring is exactly the same as your central inverter system. The next option is a microinverter system. With that system, you have individual devices that sit underneath each panel that convert DC to AC power individually for each panel. So you have as many inverters as you do have panels. There is no more central inverter. With that system, it carries the highest price point. It does allow you, though, to expand the system. If you only want to install solar on half of your roof now and wanted to expand it later at some point in time, a microinverter system might be the fit for you. So all in all, I would recommend either a power optimizer system or a microinverter system, depending on your application. The fourth item to consider is finance options. You typically have three different ways to pay for a solar system. The first is an owned system. With that, you have one payment upfront for the entire cost of the system. With that, you have all the upkeep and the maintenance. It falls on you. But on the flip side, you get all the incentives that come along with that. You get the tax credits, you get the rebates, and if your state offers renewable energy credits called SRECs, you get those too. So that's gonna have the best financial incentives, the best return on investment, and that's what I recommend for most people if you can afford it. The next option to consider is a solar loan. That is taking that upfront payment and spreading it out over a period of time, let's say 10 years. You typically get financing through a local bank at a low interest rate. And with that, you own the system after the 10 years, after it's paid off. And if it's structured correctly, what you do is you have the loan payment be less than or equal to your electrical savings. So net-net, it's not any additional payment out of pocket. The third option is a lease, a solar lease or a power purchase agreement, also called a PPA. With that, you are actually renting your roof to a third-party provider. They're coming, putting panels on your roof, and they're gonna sell you that electricity that it generates at a discount, or they're gonna offset, let's say, 10% of your bill with that. There's very little risk for you, and there's little money out of pocket for that. It's usually $0 down. On the flip side, that third-party provider gets all of the incentives. They get all the tax credits, they get all the rebates, and so it's gonna have the least amount of financial feasibility. The fifth item to consider is warranty. Most manufacturers have a performance warranty on their solar panels. This is a way to make sure that the panels are gonna produce close to their maximum power over their lifespan. Typically, the way it's structured is the panels produce 90% of their capacity for the first 10 years and then 80% for the next 15. They also have an equipment warranty. For example, most panels are warranted for 25 years, inverters, 10 years. And so if any one of those components fail within that time frame, the manufacturers will replace them. Some installers offer an installer warranty. It's basically a short period of time, somewhere between 1 and 5 years, that the installer makes sure that if there is a failed component, that there's no additional labor that needs to be paid to them to replace that component. Whichever system you choose, it will have to be installed correctly. Execution is most important. So ask your friends, family, neighbors for reputable solar companies in your area. Check for their proper certifications. These are going to vary state by state, but one that is a must-have is NABCEP. That's the North American Board of Certified Energy Practitioners. So you got to start there. And do your research online. There's a bunch of online resources and tools that are available. And there's also a bunch of lead gen services that will give you free quotes for systems on your roof. I hope this video was helpful. Thank you so much for watching, and best of luck.
Thanks for watching. This Old House has got a video for just about every home improvement project, so be sure to check out the others. And if you like what you see, click on the subscribe button to make sure that you get our newest videos right in your feed.